Hi, you're listening to the Capcom Vancouver podcast. I'm your host, Andrew Collins, and welcome to the show. So joining me in the studio today, I've got two of the senior designers for the game. So guys, if you could introduce yourselves.
I'm Roy McCombe, lead gameplay designer.
And I'm Kevin Scherbey, I'm a producer.
So you guys have been working in the studio for a long time, you tell me.
7 years, and actually the exact same amount of time.
Yes, exact. We came in together. Rose through the ranks, if you will.
Yeah.
So how did you guys start at the studio?
Development support, actually. We came in as sort of lead testers on the bigs, the very first baseball game.
And Kevin, what's your responsibility now then?
As a producer, I'm coordinating teams. I'm responsible for a team of designers as well as a couple of engineers working with animators. We're responsible for the narrative content in the game. So basically the other side that Roy is not responsible for.
And so Roy, what's the other side you look after?
We're on the gameplay side. So basically what the player does and then interacts with at a functional sort of level. Where Kevin says narrative, it's story and mission. So they'll design, obviously, the various moment to moment that the player is sort of doing throughout the story. And then we'll... On the gameplay side, it's more picking up the weapons, how the weapons work, how, you know, against the enemies.
So you guys have been on the game since day one then. How's it feel to, you know, to kind of look back on the first day that we started on DR3 to look at what we've got now? How does that feel?
Surreal, I think, a little bit. It's changed a lot since we first started. But looking at it now, it's definitely a source of pride. And I think... picking up the controller and pressing new game and actually playing it as a player right now, as a gamer, is really fun and validating.
It's a lot of fun. It is. It really is. A lot of us are going through playing the game now. And I think a lot of us, now that we've had a moment to sort of step back and play the game, we're having tons of fun. And I mean, we came from DR2, which was an awesome opportunity. And it was it's tons of fun. Like, we've evolved it, and it feels like a lot of things that we wanted to do in 2 is in 3 now. So,
because I think a lot of people who don't make games don't really understand that sensation of when you're deep in the game, you're so close to it that you don't really see kind of the... It's easy to forget that there is a game that you're making because you're so close to your little section.
Yeah, when you're that close to it mid development, you only see the problems.
Yeah.
So when you get a chance for gamers to see even just slices of it, like at the shows that we've been doing, and they react in a positive way, it's definitely validating to you to know that you're making something fun, and it's a nice reminder that you know people out there like what you're doing.
I always used to be amused when people think that working on a video game means that you play the game all the time.
That you hear that all the time.
That's what you do for a job.
And even you just play games all day. Why do you do it when you go home?
Well, the games I play at home aren't broken.
That's right. Yeah.
That's pretty much. And when DR3 is finished, I'll play that at home. So one of the main things you guys are looking after now is you've been visiting all around the world, you know, showing the game to gamers. How's that gone?
Oh, that's been an unreal experience doing the PR tour for the game. I've been to E3 in Los Angeles, did that with Roy. After that, I went to San Diego Comic-Con. Then I was in Germany doing the Gamescom trip in Cologne. And then where did I go? Went to PAX in Seattle. And then I'll be going into San Francisco soon. Where did you go, Roy?
I went to... E3, of course, as you mentioned, which was just surreal. As you had stated earlier, it's fantastic. And
How did that feel when, you know, Josh appeared on the stage and suddenly we were...
The hair on the back of my neck stood up.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Like, literally did. And the fan reaction was amazing. Like, I've seen videos, the recordings, and I actually don't feel it did it enough justice. Like, being in there and hearing how loud the audience got was... It was overwhelming in a lot of ways.
It was crazy. For some of the guys that were actually at the Microsoft conference, there was tears. Because of the emotion and seeing everybody react so positively to it after working on it for a number of years was crazy.
Yeah, there was, I mean, obviously there was the initial concerns because we were showing the darker side, the contrast. But I think, you know, it's really helped us in the end, where people are really seeing that we haven't lost the touch of what DR really is, and the fun factors that make the fans really love it.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of really fun gameplay in there.
And so one of the things you guys have been doing is actually dealing face to face with those fans and showing them the game. How's that been going?
The fans themselves are overwhelmed. Like, a lot of the ones that we've spoken to just cannot wait to get their hands on it. Obviously the ones that we've spoken to have seen the game and they're just amazed at how much content's in there, and they're just, it's over the top, and they think it's just, they love it. And I love to even see the new fans that have said, you know, I haven't been interested until now. You've really got my attention.
Yeah.
And I think the biggest one that many of us would say is, I'm buying an Xbox because of this game. Like, that's unbelievable. It's amazing to hear that sort of thing.
So some of the best fans that I've encountered were actually at PAX. Some of the most hardcore guys that played Dead Rising 1, played Dead Rising 2, played Case Zero, played Case West, and they've been searching the internet for a while for any detail on Dead Rising 3. So when they came to see the show there, and I was doing the presentation, anytime I talk about Dead Rising 2, they're nodding, they're cheering, mm-hmm. right? And then coming afterwards and shaking my head and introducing themselves and saying, I love what you're doing.
Yeah.
And that's really, really
satisfying.
It's satisfying. It's a great feeling.
Yeah, I absolutely. Guess you need posters of those guys when you're finally in the game to help you really, you know, get it over the line.
Yeah, seriously.
It
yeah.
is. We love getting pictures with them, taking pictures, signing if they want to sign stuff. We're fans ourselves. Like, we were working at a different company when the first one came out, and we talked about it a ton, and we wouldn't even have dreamed that we would actually be where we are now at that time. So it was fantastic to actually see that sort of thing. And or be part of that experience, and seeing the fans that love it, and being able to say we're fans as well, and we're really happy to see that fans loving the game.
How did you approach doing all the public speaking that you've been doing? Because, you know, you get a lot of people that look at that and think, I could never do that.
We did a lot of prep in the studio, where we'd have our team that would be going to the shows actually sitting, critiquing us, talk about the game, and also critiquing their peers playing the game, because obviously that's being a cameraman as well, as part of it. And personally, I found actually it was more stressful, and I got more butterflies presenting to my fellow designers and producers, because their job there was to critique me.
Yeah.
Whereas when I go to the show, the game actually really speaks for itself, and people are there to see the awesome stuff in the game. And really, if I do a good job, I'm just enhancing that. They're not really judging me with what I say. So I actually found that when I was doing the actual shows, I didn't have butterflies. It was more just pride and adrenaline that was pushing me through it.
Yeah.
The reception's the big one. Like, I think as many people, it seems so obvious that it's the initial presentation with when there's more and more and more people that you end up presenting to. The last one that I was at, there was 300 to 400 people at any given sitting. When you think about it, that's scary, but after you do it, that's not the big deal. It's not screwing up. Like, on my side, I would play through while they would be talking, and you don't want to screw up. And playing the game, or what I should say is showing the game, is different from playing a game, because you don't want people to get sick, right? from camera moving all over the place too quickly or whatever, so, and showing the right things. So it's different nerves.
At E3 was our coming out party. Mm. Everyone wanted to know more about Dead Rising 3, so it was easy for us to present because the game really, really spoke for itself.
The awards, it was just, they kept coming every day, and going out to be able to see the various awards that we were getting, even nominated for, just seeing the nominations was really, really...
Well, it vindicates all your efforts, doesn't
yes.
it?
Yeah, it absolutely does.
And it's nice to know that someone agrees with you that what you've done, what you've sweated into, is mm-hmm. worth it.
A recent trip that I was on as well, while Kevin was away in Europe at the Gamescom in Germany, Josh and I had to go to Vegas and do a show, and there was well over 6,000, 8,000 people in the audience when Josh came up on stage, and everyone went crazy. And ultimately, they ended up talking about the game, and we ended up getting pretty much a standing ovation. And seeing that again is like being in the middle of it is just, it's amazing. It's all of your hard work, blood, sweat, and tears with your team, and trying to even come back and convey that to your team is it's really awesome when you're closing out a game, especially.
Another thing that makes me feel good about these trips is actually getting the opportunity to bring designers along with us on the trip, so they can see firsthand the reaction to what they've been building for the last few years. And that, I think, is a great opportunity and kind of makes me all tingly inside for them to get that chance to meet those fans.
Yeah, it's definitely, you know, even moving forward in their career and stuff, understanding who the fans are and how much they appreciate what you do, you know, but even you don't want to screw up, right? You want to do your damnedest to make sure all the decisions you're making, all the features you're working on are to the best they possibly can be. You know there's fans on the other end playing your game and they're critiquing what you've done, right? Judging you. Mm-hmm. It's just like a movie. It takes 3 years or so to make a movie or a game or something, but it takes an hour and a half for somebody just to judge 3 years of your life. So
that's a very bleak way of thinking about it.
So don't screw it up.
Yeah, don't screw it up. You got 3 years, and in an hour you're going to be judged. So it's crazy.
So it sounds like it's been a pretty positive experience. What would you say has been the hardest thing that you guys have had to do?
For me as a presenter, it was the E3 show in general. The amount of presentations that we had to do, the number of people that wanted to see the game because it was their first time hearing about it, was astronomical. So when we would do a theater show, you know, when you would normally have a break, those people file out and a camera crew comes in and you do an interview and then they leave and more people come in and you're into the next presentation. At that show, I literally had to run to go to the bathroom to come back and do another show. And so the producer group certainly lost their voices. We had a sweet Clint Eastwood thing going on at the end where we were like, Dead Rising 3. it was pretty cool, but exhausting, rewarding, but exhausting.
Mm-hmm. There was a moment where I think it was the second day we ended up having in another show, basically after the show. It was international press that was in the booth, and it was pretty cool. We had a quick scrum, like the entire group, the whole E3 group was in there, and Josh said, you guys don't have to stay, whoever can, I really appreciate it. But, you know, you guys have put in a lot of effort already because we didn't really have any breaks, as Kevin was explaining, after a full day of E3. And then basically we said, you know what, we're a team. We came here. Let's do it. And so that was it. It was basically we all split and took turns on as far as the presenters. They took turns. And then those of us that weren't playing or whatever, we made sure that the people waiting were, you know, entertained and, yeah. You know, it was good. It was a nice stretch.
Major team effort. And like I said, even bringing those junior guys, they stepped up as well. Really showed their commitment to the team and the game. And they were all very proud. So it was a really cool feeling. And that 12 or 13 straight hours that day, they still stepped up. So that was cool.
Yeah. And then it was back at it again the next day.
Yep. Bright and early.
Bright and early. Yeah. E3 doesn't start when the doors open.
That's right.
For us.
So are you, as well as Kevin's been doing the worldwide stuff, you've been traveling a lot. As well as E3, where did you go?
So after E3, we went to Fan Expo in Toronto, which was really, really cool. Got to meet hands-on fans, basically, right? And they just wanted to see more. And we were showing off combo vehicles at that time, so that was really cool. And then we took that same demo. What do we call them? Red eyes. So left Vancouver on a red eye, arrived really early in Toronto, demoed that the next day, and then red-eyed out to Vegas, and then showed it off there at a big convention with thousands and thousands of people. It was a retail convention, and that was awesome. It was great to see the retail side of things and present to them and see how excited they were.
This is the first time you guys have kind of gone through this this series of shows to promote a game.
Yes.
Yeah, first time in a PR sort of role.
Mm-hmm.
How's it compared to what you thought it would be like?
I think, you know, there's a lot of people just want to go to the shows. They want to be part of it. They, you know, I think the biggest thing that we would probably say is it's work. It's a lot of effort to even the initial planning, the initial stresses to make sure that what you're showing is exactly what you want to show it off, and it comes across the way you're really hoping it will come across to the fans. And then the actual just back-to-back-to-back, as Kevin has explained, it's a lot of work that goes into these shows, and there's really no downtime. The downtime's at the end of the night when you eat dinner, but you're so tired, you basically eat dinner, maybe drink a beer, and then go back to your hotel and sleep, and then it all starts over again.
Yeah, put it this way, the initial reaction is, I get to go to E3,
mm-hmm.
and then we realize that at the end of E3, we came back and people were saying, what do you think of this game that got announced at E3? And we were like, that was there?
Yeah.
Like, we had no idea what other companies were presenting because we didn't have any time to leave our booth, essentially.
Yeah. Yeah. Some of us only had an hour set aside that we could walk there. And if anybody that was at E3 knows that they can't walk the entire floor in 1 hour.
No.
So that's what some of us basically had right before the show shut down. I mean, really, it was fantastic to be part of that whole other side of the experience.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, gents, well, it's been great to talk to you. Thanks for all your time, and I should let you get back to the game. Good luck, and we'll speak to you again soon.
Thank you very much for having us.
Always a pleasure, Andrew.
Yeah.
Cheers, guys.